All right, welcome to video number 3 in the Get Email Marketing Clients video series. We're going to talk about how to reach out to clients without feeling like a sleazeball, something that a lot of people have, they struggle with. So I'm going to make sure that you're, after you watch this, you're going to be a pro at reaching out to clients. So here's what we're going to cover on this video. We already talked about two different videos, the freelance copywriting model explained and your dream client, how to get them. If you haven't watched those videos, make sure you go back and watch that first before you watch this one, or it's not going to make any sense. Here's where we are today, and we have two more coming after this. So what we're covering on this video, the PQC sales process explained, we're going to give you a bird's eye view of what you're doing throughout the sales process, how to identify your prospect or your dream client's hangout spots so that you can reach out and get a response, how to reach out in a non-douchey, non-spammy way, the 7-hour rule of getting a client, 5 tips to rise above the spam, and they're interested. What now? What do you do next? All right, so we're gonna talk about all that today in this video. It's gonna be a bit of a longer one, but you're gonna get a ton of value out of this. So first, the PQC sales process explained. What does the sales process look like? What are we actually doing through this, this process here? The P stands for prospect, the Q stands for qualify, and the C stands for close. So in the prospect step here, step number 1, we are reaching out to our dream clients. We're identifying them and reaching out on these different platforms, right? Wherever they're hanging out. So we're gonna figure out where they're hanging out first, and then we're gonna reach out to our prospects on those platforms. So it could be LinkedIn, could be Facebook, Facebook groups, it could be Instagram, could be cold emails. It could also be when you're connecting with people, there's also inbound. That's why this is orange or yellow, whatever this color is here. Once you are connecting with people on whatever platform you're on, you're gonna be posting content to get potential clients to come to you, to reach out and say, hey, Sean, I'm interested in learning more about what you do. I saw your post on X, Y, and Z, right? So after you're prospecting and reaching out, the goal is to get every prospect that you're reaching out to who is a good fit on the on a phone call, right? A 15-minute discovery call. So this is where we're qualifying them and we're making sure that they are a good fit. We can get them results, right? Very important that you, in the last video, we talked about the 5 criteria, making sure that you find prospects and only work with clients that you can get results for, that are a good fit for your service. And then if they're a good fit on this 15-minute discovery call, you are going to do a demo or a strategy session where you're closing them and actually turning them from an interested lead into a paying client. Okay, so this is the sales process, the PQC sales process. Very simple, prospect, qualify, close. Let's break it down a little more in detail what we're doing in each step. First, you're gonna optimize your social profiles, wherever they're hanging out, to reflect who you are, who you help, and how you help them. So whenever a prospect lands on your social media, let's say your Facebook or your LinkedIn or your Instagram, they should be able to know exactly who you are, who you help, and how you help them, right? What's your service offering there? You're gonna perform outbound prospecting. So this is a form of direct outreach that generates leads and appointments of people who are interested and who are a good fit for what you have to offer. In this case, it's email copywriting. You can also post social selling content on your profiles that's relevant to your niche, tied back to your service, and the goal of this is to attract prospects, get them to come to you, right? So as you're connecting with people on Instagram or Facebook or LinkedIn and you're posting this content, you're sprinkling it on there on your profiles, you're gonna have prospects reading that, people you connected with, and getting more and more accustomed to who you are and what you offer. We'll talk about the 7-hour rule in a few slides from now. And eventually some people are gonna reach out and say, hey, I'd like to learn more about what you do. How can we get on a phone call to chat more, right? That's the goal of this. Once you get someone to say, yes, I'm interested from prospecting, you're gonna jump on that 15-minute discovery call with that prospect. And the goal again is to qualify them and ensure you're fit to work together. Super important, don't take on clients that you can't get results for or it's gonna bite you in the arse. If they're a fit, you can schedule time for a demo or a strategy session to walk through your service, explain to them how it's gonna help them go from wherever their current situation is that they don't like to the desired situation or desired result that they do want in their business. If the prospect is ready to go, which is gonna be a little more rare where you're closing them on that first call for thousands of dollars, a cold, ice cold prospect, does happen, but it doesn't always happen. It's rare to see that. You can actually sign them up on the spot if they are ready to go. So that's the sales process explained. Let's talk about how to identify your dream client's hangout spots. How do you figure out where they hang out online so that you can reach out and get the best possible response rate? So different niches hang out in different places. For example, software companies. LinkedIn and Facebook groups are great places if you're targeting software founders. So LinkedIn, you can target based on job title and industry, and software is one of those. Facebook groups, there are a ton of Facebook groups with software founders in there. So these are the two different places that I might look to see where these software companies are hanging out. Influencers, where do they hang out? Instagram and YouTube, maybe even email, right? E-com store owners, Facebook groups, and email, right? There's tons of Facebook groups for e-commerce store owners, and you can also reach them through just directly emailing them. So I like to identify the top places that whatever niche that I pick, where they hang out, so that I know the best places to reach them. So I like to identify the best places, the top places that whatever niche that I pick hangs out, so that I know the best places that I can reach them and get a response. And what we're gonna be doing is these three steps. Number one, we're gonna identify their hangout spots. You're gonna list out the different social media platforms or the forums or the groups and the mediums that they spend the most time on. You are going to make a lead list. So you need their name, their company, their email, their social media links where you can reach them. And this can be done manually for free, where you're just manually researching and filling out a spreadsheet or a Google sheet with this information. Or you can use a virtual assistant and or use the software for a small investment, right? There's software out there that helps you to build these lists based on your criteria. Number three, you're gonna create an outreach plan, right? Very important that you create this and stick to it. So you might say, I'll reach out to X number of prospects every day on 1 to 3 different mediums. And for example, it might say, I will reach out to 15 prospects every day on Instagram DMs and email. And it's, again, it's important that you just not only create this plan, but you actually stick to it for at least 30 to 60 days or so. Volume does matter, right? The more people that you reach out to, the more at-bats and the more chances that you're gonna have to get a client. So create this outreach plan, create this statement for yourself, and actually be consistent with it and do it. Now let's talk about what to say in these messages, right? So once you've done these three steps, let's talk about what to say in the messages that you're using to reach out to people. So, how to reach out in a non-douchey, non-spammy, non-annoying way. And most people just don't know how to do this. The truth is, most outreach messages suck, absolutely suck. And they still suck, even with all the information out there on how to send better outreach messages for free on YouTube or just trainings on the topic. It's just crazy to me how bad these outreach messages are. So here's a few, right? I'm gonna show you examples of a few really bad ones. So this is the first one. This one really pissed me off. This dude tried to pull a fast one on me. So look at his subject line. Trump wants to make things easier. And this is not about politics. I'm not gonna tell you what I align with or what I believe in. That's not what this video is for. But he leads with the subject line, Trump wants to make things easier. His first subject or first sentence was, how is my pop culture subject line? And then he goes into this long pitch that has nothing to do with Trump, right? So if he said something about Trump in the subject line and he tied it back somehow to his service offering, I don't know how he would do that. There are ways to do it, but he could have tied it back and I would have bid. I might have bid on it because it is a solution. What he was pitching was something that I needed, but he tried to pull a fast one, right? He didn't say anything else about Trump. He just wanted me to get me to open the email, and it just pissed me off, right? It started the relationship on the wrong foot. I didn't even want to talk to him after that. I basically told him, you know, go pound sand, dude. You need to fix your messaging, because if you're trying to trick people, you're starting the relationship off on tricking people, you're not going to get very far. So this is this isn't the worst cold email that I've seen, like in terms of copy, but in terms of like trying to make me feel dumb, this guy succeeded, right? Like he made me feel dumb for like even opening it up and pissed me off, right? Which is what you don't want to do to a prospect that you want to do business with. So that's example number one. Number two, yes, this is a cold email. It looks like it was sent by a robot to a robot. Like, doesn't say my name anywhere. There's all this weird formatting and images in here. I don't even know how I got in this. This is a cold email. I didn't sign up for any list or newsletter from this company, and they're sending me emails like this. These are a few emails, one of a few emails from this company that was in my spam box. Yes, this is a cold email, by the way. It's not a newsletter, even though it looks like it. And this is one of the worst cold emails that I have, worst cold email barrages. She sent about 46 different emails, and they were all equally bad. So just read this. Hi, just following up really quick in hopes of actually getting a response soon. I hope my email is not sent to spam. Surprise, it was. Please respond as soon as you can. Subject line, re, is this email still active? I didn't reply, so again, she's trying to trick me, and she's pairing that with really bad copy. Is this email not in use anymore? This email was the only one I could find, or maybe you're just busy. I don't know, but I hope you received my emails. Like, what, Rebecca, why would I respond to you? You're not even telling me why you're reaching out, right? So she hasn't told me what's in it for me, why she's reaching out. What? Why does she want me to respond? Like, what am I gonna say? Hi? Like, why do you want me to respond so badly where you're gonna send 46 emails and not tell me once why you want me to respond to you? I'm just gonna try one more time. Please, if you see my message, can you respond to me? I honestly hope everything has been going well. Be safe out there. And this was not the last email. So this one where she said, I'm gonna try one more time, she probably sent about a dozen more emails after this. So this is what you're dealing with. This is what you're up against, right? Do you think you can beat these emails? I think you can, right? With this simple training, this simple video here that I'm showing you, I think you're gonna be able to write better cold emails and outreach emails than those people, for sure. It ain't hard to do. It ain't hard to write good cold emails if you follow a proven framework and just act like a real human, right? Don't act like robots or like irritating people where you're trying to trick them on the first point of contact, or you're sending to a robot, or you're just sending spam like this where you're not even telling the person why you want them to respond. If you can do better than that, you're gonna be just fine. So how to reach out in a non-douchey way. Here is a framework that you can follow. A personalized subject line. Sean, loved your YouTube video on email list building. The body copy, it will be a personalized snippet. You wanna share something about the person that you're reaching out to. You wanna call out the problem, tell them how you can help them solve it. You wanna provide some kind of social proof or credibility or sample of your work if you have it. You can add a personalized Loom or Vidyard video as a bonus, and then you're gonna have a call to action. Tell them to reply to your message if they're interested in learning more, all right? Here is an example. Hey, Sean, loved your video on email list building. Your tip about using Facebook groups to grow your audience and list at the same time was killer and something I'll be applying right away. Personalized snippet with a compliment. Anyway, the reason I'm reaching out is I joined your email list a few weeks back and noticed you didn't have a welcome sequence in place to sell your ebook. You could be converting a lot more of your leads into customers using an automated 7 to 10 email welcome sequence. Introducing the problem, right? The problem is I didn't have an automated sequence set up, in this example at least. The solution, I'd love to help you put this sequence in place so you can add another 10 to 20% to your revenue on autopilot. And I wrote a couple sample emails that you can take a look at. That's how you're telling them, you can help them solve it, and you're gonna provide some samples to that as well. Just reply back to let me know if you'd like to see them. CTA, reply to learn more, right? Now with the samples here, the cool thing that you can do is you can tell them you wrote a couple samples. You don't have to write two samples for every single prospect you reach out to. If someone replies back, like let's say for example, someone sent this to me and I replied back, I would then very quickly write up a couple samples and send it over for them to look at, right? So you're only spending time on people who responded. Cheers, non-douchey value first outreacher. So what we're doing here is, oops, we provided value. We told them how we can help them solve a problem and we dangled the carrot, right? We gave the person a reason to respond. We told them that we have these sample emails that can help them add 10 to 20% to their revenue on autopilot using this automated email welcome sequence. We dangled the carrot, gave them a reason to reach out and respond, all right? So let's talk about the 7-hour rule of getting a client. Now, if you look at this, okay, this is from a startup website. They talk about this in the startup world a lot. Big decisions take 7 hours. Something magical happens after 7 hours, right? So over here, they use an example. Whether you're buying a new car, making a new career move, engaging a consultant, or choosing an annual holiday destination, if you add up all the time you spend thinking about it, you can be fairly sure it totals more than 7 hours, right? Something magical happens after 7 hours. If you've invested 7 hours in getting to know a person or a topic, it's because you've established a high degree of relevance, emotional connection, trust, rapport, understanding, and even bonding to the person or idea. So how does it work? How does this apply to getting a client? Simple. Your goal is to clock up 7 hours with as many people as possible. And you don't wanna do this in a creepy, annoying, or pestering way. You wanna spend 7 hours, you want people to spend 7 hours with you, right? Through your content, through your outreach, through anything that you're posting on your social media platforms. That all contributes to your 7-hour rule, to the 7-hour rule of client getting. Now, how to smash the 7-hour rule, and I'm gonna abbreviate it 7HR for brevity here. Number one, follow up like a bad date. right? Your first touch point will rarely ever get responded to. You should be following up multiple times across the different platforms that they hang out on. You should have a list of this from the previous step. You're gonna come at it from a different angle so that you're not annoying, right? You're not just gonna keep saying, hey, just following up, hey, just following up, like Rebecca in the previous bad example, right? You wanna change up the angle whenever you reach out. Share a customer success story, a new insight, or a new tactic or strategy that can help them get a quick win, right? Customer testimonial. That's what I mean by customer success story here. So that's number one, follow up like a bad date, create and share content. Creating valuable content can go a long way in getting the prospect closer to becoming a client. So a very brilliant marketer named Travis Sago, he always uses the analogy of putting and golf. He says that when all your marketing and all the content, it gets the ball, the golf ball, closer and closer and closer to the hole so that by the time the sales call actually comes, it's just a little tap into the hole. It's very close to the hole already, and the prospect is already very close to becoming a client. So I post content, obviously, on YouTube, my Facebook group, on LinkedIn, that does a lot of the heavy lifting for my sales process. So again, think the putting example, right? Where every piece of content you put out there, it bumps the ball closer and closer and closer to the hole so that by the time that you're getting on the phone to close, it's just a little tap into the hole at that point. It's not like a long putt. All right. Number three, start an email list and have a daily email. Right? If you have a list of people who have chosen to hear from you and you're in their ear every day, you can smash that 7HR pretty quick. And this works for any industry, local business, digital product creators, e-com stores, coaches, consultants, service providers. As long as you're selling to someone who can read and you're sending a daily email, you're gonna smash that 7HR really quickly. Right? I have people reaching out to me from my daily emails that I send out, of course, every day, that inquire about the different offerings that I have because they've been seeing me sending an email out for months, right? So always be thinking, has the prospect crossed the 7-hour rule? And if not, what can I do to move the prospect closer to it, to that 7 hours with you, right? Following up, creating, sharing content, starting an email list with a daily email. These are my favorite ways to do it and probably the simplest ways that you can do it. Simple, not easy. Now, if you can hit the 7HR, the prospect will be 80 to 90% closed by the time they talk to you, which is what you want. You don't want it to be a slog by the time you get on the call. It feels like you're pulling teeth and you're trying to convince them from scratch why they should sign up with you. If you can hit the 7HR, it makes your sales process and the actual closing process a whole lot easier. They just need a little nudge at that point to push them over the edge, right? If you've actually done the 7HR and they get on the phone with you or they're reaching out after seeing your content, they just need a little nudge that pushes them over the edge into becoming a paying client. So, 5 tips to rise above the spam. There's so much spam out there today and it's harder than ever to stick out because everyone's online, everyone's moving into doing outreach and reaching out to prospects and potential clients, and people are getting hammered by messages. So here are 5 tips to rise above the spam and stand out. Number one, use humor, right? You don't need to be a stand-up comedian. You wanna keep it light, add a bit of humor in your message. For example, I use the subject line, Sean, I'm coming in ice cold, but I'm hoping to help, right? That's just some very light humor. It's you know, acknowledging the fact that we're coming in cold to the prospect. They've never met us before, but we wanna help them. And they're gonna, you know, this is one of my best performing subject lines right here. Number two, keep it short and to the point. No one wants to hear your life story in a cold message. I've seen some people teaching on YouTube, like they want to hear about, like, you know, your journey, your hero's journey or whatever it is. No one wants to hear that stuff in a cold message. They don't know you. They don't care. So be concise with your message and get to why they should pay attention really fast, really quickly. Once they are in your world, maybe they opted into your list or they're in your group if you have a Facebook group or they're watching you on YouTube, then you can share your life story if you want. But in a cold message, a cold outreach message, do not go into a long drawn out message. They don't care about that. Number three, keep it human. Please, please ditch this, the dear sirs and madams. This actually does still happen quite a bit. To whom it may concern, I'd like to see if there's synergy between us. Oh my God, that's robotic shite. No one talks like that. Like, who actually talks like that in person? Make it conversational and as you would talk to a friend. I'm not saying to be unprofessional, I'm just saying keep it conversational. Don't be so uptight. If you wouldn't say it in real life, don't say it in an email, right? Just read it out loud and make sure that it flows naturally and that it's actually something that you would say to a friend, right, in real life. Number four, provide value and results in advance. So my cold message example, I offer to write a couple sample emails that they could use. And you don't have to write them beforehand either. Dangle the value carrot so that they have a reason to reply. And then once they reply, then you can write those emails. Then you can put your time and focus into someone who's responded to that. Number five, shoot a 30-second video. Most people are afraid of getting on camera. There are free tools like Loom and Vidyard to do this. Simply shoot a video on their, have the actual screen on their site or their social profile, restate what it says in your email, and then remember the 7HR, the 7-hour rule, right? Also, people connect better with you when they can see you on video. So when you have an email there, you send an email and you have a link to a video where they can actually see you, this all builds up that 7HR. They see you on video, they connect, people connect with other people when they can see them. And if you send a video, you're standing out from all the other people that don't want it. 99% of people won't send a video. So if you send a video, you're gonna stand out from all the other people that don't wanna do that, okay? So they're interested. What now? What do you do next? Congrats, you did the hardest part. You captured their attention and you got them to agree to that first meeting. This, I truly believe this is the hardest part, especially nowadays when you're reaching out to a cold prospect and they're getting hammered by all these other messages. I think the hardest part is getting them to agree to that first meeting. This is the start of your sales process, right? Remember PQC. This is just the P, and we're now getting them to the Q, the qualify where you're getting on that discovery call. You will now be taking the conversation to a phone call and to learn more about their business and see if you can actually help them. We'll talk more about this next week, right? So actually getting on the phone, what do you say? What's the flow of the sales call? What are you doing throughout? Like, what should you be thinking throughout the sales call? Some mindset and sales tips. We'll talk more about all this stuff next week. So recap of what we covered, a long video, but I hope you got a ton of value out of this. The PQC sales process explained, prospect, qualify, close, how to identify your dream client's hangout spots, how to reach out in a non-douchey way, non-douchey, non-spammy, non-annoying way, the 7-hour rule of getting a client, 5 tips to rise above the spam, and they're interested, what do you do next? Which is, you're gonna hop on a phone call with them, that 15-minute discovery call to qualify them, see if they're a fit. So next week, how to close deals on the phone like a boss, even if you have zero sales experience. If you haven't yet, make sure you join my free Facebook group. Go to emailrainmaker.com. It's gonna take you directly to the group. You're gonna answer 3 questions, and I approve it usually within a couple of days or so. And I share a lot more email marketing, email copywriting content in there as well. If you like this video, you got value out of it, make sure you like it, comment below with any questions you have, and I will see you next week for video number 4 in the series. Take care, see you soon.